Greetings, beloved. I'm Dr. Felicia LaBoy, lead pastor and life coach here at the historic First United Methodist Church in downtown Elgin, Illinois, with another motivational moment from the Bible. These motivational moments are designed to help you take what you hear in church on Sunday, what you may learn in Sunday school, what you may read during your private devotional time, to take those biblical concepts and to make them a part of your everyday life. This week, I want us to focus in on this idea, imagine that, reimagine us. Imagine that, reimagine us. Now, I know you all must be thinking, what's Pastor Felicia up to at the beginning of 2022? I'm so glad that you asked. If you've been following along with the lectionary calendar, the lectionary basically is a way to help us read through the Bible over a three-year period by following the life of Jesus, by following from Jesus' birth, which we do during Advent to Christmas, and then, you know, the first Sunday in January is usually Epiphany Sunday, right? It's the day that the wise men see the stars, they see the light, and they come to see the baby Jesus. And then we go through baptism of Jesus all the way till we get around to Easter. That's a long story for another day. But right now, we are in the season of Epiphany. And for those of you who don't know, Epiphany means that you see something different. You get a flash of insight, inspiration, something that's been there all along. Now, when we look at it, it can be something greater than it's been. It can be something more than it's been. It is literally to see the light. It's to have an aha moment. When we think about it, the church should be full of aha moments. We should always be looking around to see where God is moving, where God is working. We should be looking in the face of not only our family and friends, but of strangers, for those who are down and out, for those who are lost and hurting and in pain, to see where we see the face of God. But even more than that, beloved, we have to be people who have aha moments, who can not only imagine, but reimagine, not just simple things, but you and I have to be bold enough to reimagine and to imagine ourselves differently and to imagine our church differently. What are you talking about, Pastor Felicia? Well, let me put it this way. Many of us are desiring to get back to normal when it comes to church, right? We want the church to be as it was when it was flourishing. We want families. We want all kinds of programs. We want everything. Eek! The gospel never tells us to bring people to church. It says that we are go to the people and introduce them to Christ. One of the things that you'll notice in the book of Acts is that when the early church got comfortable, can you imagine Peter preaches? He gets 3,000 people, right? They have a system. They know how things are supposed to go. All that gets disrupted, and it forces the church to go out into the world. And by going out into the world, they encounter different cultures and different people, and they meet people, and they spread the good news of the life-saving message of Jesus Christ. Beloved, that was then, and that was now. And I'm not saying that the church is not important, but the church is not the building. The church is us, the people. What would it mean for us to reimagine who we could be if our goal was simply to spread the message of Jesus Christ to the ends of the earth and to transform the world around us? Think about what that would look like. I know if you ask me, what vision do I see for our church? I see a place that is radically inclusive. That we have folks from every tribe and nation, every ability, every gender, every sexual orientation, that people come, that they feel loved and accepted, that there's a place for them to share their gifts. It doesn't matter how old they are, how young they are, that this is a place where all are valued and all are shared. And that we're not incorporating people into a system, right? But that we are an incarnational church. And what I mean by that is that we are open to changing as new people begin to come. So what does that mean, Pastor Felicia? I'm so glad you asked. What it means is that, beloved, we know that we can't just focus on being a church that's present in the building, right? So all of our programs can't be in the building. We're going to have to be a hybrid church. Not only to offer worship or to offer these motivational moments, we're going to have to do more than just offering maybe two Bible studies. We're going to have to figure out how to offer ways for fellowship and to bring people together, how to offer ways that allow people to do mission projects or volunteer things like that, right? To ask questions, to participate in meetings, to be able to serve if they want to. We're going to create hybrid church. We're also going to have blended worship, right? We know that the church has made a massive investment in our organ. But organ music doesn't speak to everyone. And as I say over and over again, what many people are unaware of is that the hymns that we hold to be so sacred, Charles and John Wesley simply took those words and set them to bar tunes, to the contemporary music of the day. Beloved, you and I, if we want young people in the church, we're going to have some more contemporary music. We also might have to look at the time that we gather. 9 a.m. may not work for families where both parents are working, and now we're some 60% of our neighbors travel at least 40 minutes one way out of our community to go to work. Not only that, beloved, you and I are going to have to look at how do we reach out into the community by meeting specific needs. Everything tells us in the research, even when I went to go spend some time at North Central College with the campus minister there, young adults are not interested in just sitting up on a Sunday service and singing in a choir and doing things that maybe you and I consider to be church. They want to be hands-on and they want to make a difference. They are quite generous with their time and money if they have the opportunity. Part of that is the reason why we've created a community development corporation. What is that, Pastor Felicia? Community Development Corporation is a vehicle by which churches set up this nonprofit so that they can do what normally would be outreach, really what we should say is just church work, that they can do that work, and also recognizing that we have older congregation that allows us to hire some people, that allows us to be able to get grants and to do some things. But as we begin to do that kind of ministry in the world, then it allows other folks who may not give to the church or who may not want to participate in church per se, it allows them to volunteer, it allows them to give, it allows them to participate with the work that the church is doing. And then with the encounters and interactions with the church, and as people get used to coming to church, then usually something miraculous happens. People who may not have been open to just coming to church come to church, come to Christ because they come through this other vehicle. By the name of a community development corporation. If you really want to know how that works well within our own system, you can look at the Church for All People in Columbus, Ohio. You can look at the Emory Fellowship in Washington, D.C. You can look at Windsor Village in Houston, Texas. And you can look at St. John's in downtown Houston, Texas. All of those places started small, but began to meet the needs of the community around them, to just try to build up the community around them. And those churches are flourishing and all kinds of people are coming. Some come through the doors on Sunday morning. Some come through because they're volunteering. Some come through because they're curious and they want to know what's going on. Some come through because they donate their money and they want to see what's going on. Beloved, you know, at the heart of our faith is the idea of repentance. And most people think that repentance means to be sad. No, repentance means to be like a caterpillar, to go through that kind of transformation. This passage here in Ephesians puts it well. It says that God is able to do far above, far more than we can dare to ask or think or even imagine, according to the power that works in us. What that means is that if we will give our will, our mind, our emotions, our time, our talent, our resources, if we will surrender all to God, if we will begin to be willing to struggle with God, then what God will do is not remake us into what we were. He will remake us into something more glorious. He will remake us into a butterfly. He will remake us into what he has designed us to be and what he's calling us to be during this season. Beloved, remember the mission is not to recreate or resuscitate what was. It is to enter into resurrection power, a power that is able to go far beyond what we dare to even ask, think, or imagine, and to reimagine a new future that God is calling us into. What an aha moment. You ask me, how are we going to know? I don't know. God usually walks things out. He doesn't always tell you what's what ahead of time, probably because we'd walk away. But beloved, I don't know. I'm excited about this venture that God is calling us on. I can't wait to see what God is going to do with us and through us, with our new equipment for reaching folks online, with our new community development corporation, the business and nonprofit development center at First, with the new programs we have in partnership with the city of Elgin in terms of working with people who are homeless and with those youth and young adults who are struggling. I can't wait to see what God wants to do through us. It's gonna be glorious. And then we can say, as God has been working with us and through us, imagine that. Imagine that God could do all of this with us at our age, at our time, in our history. Wow. We are so glad that we were able to reimagine us. I pray this week that you will stick around for this Refresh Your Soul moment, which is a song by Kirk Franklin and the family called Imagine Me. And at the heart of that song, it says, when I can get past all that I see as my limitations and my fear, then I can imagine me the way that God imagines me. And I think that that's not only for us personally, but I think it's for us as a church. And not only us as a church, for all churches. So stick around and catch that song. Beloved, I am Dr. Felicia LaVoy, lead pastor and life coach here at the historic First United Methodist Church in downtown Elgin, Illinois, with another motivational moment from the Bible. I'll see you next week. Love you. Bye-bye.
Thank you for allowing me to see myself the way you see me. Thank you.
Imagine me
being free.
Self-esteem. You never felt good enough. You never felt pretty enough. But imagine God whispering in your ear, letting you know that everything that has happened is now. It's all gone. Every sin, every mistake, every failure, it's all gone. Depression, gone. Self-esteem, hallelujah, it's gone,
it's gone,
all gone,
all gone,
all
gone,
it's gone, all my scars, all my pain, it's in the past, it's yesterday,
it's gone,
it's all gone,
it's gone, it's
gone, what your mother did, what your father did, hallelujah,
all gone.